Yes. If you're keeping track, this is what we call a sellout crowd right here. And it's all for our first keynote speaker from Founders Workshop, one of the pillars of emerging technology here in Phoenix. Please help me welcome Vincent Serpico, everybody.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Thanks for showing up. So, I've got 2 hours of information to present in 15 minutes, so please listen fast. This is going to be about generative AI, and I know there's a lot of people in the audience right now who are already doing amazing things with generative AI. Can I see your hands, please? Is already doing some really cool things. Very cool. Very, of course, Barbara, naturally. And I know there's some people who have been playing around with generative AI and want to explore more. Can I see a raise of hands for those who are okay? And those who've heard of generative AI but haven't done anything with it yet, can I see a show of hands? Okay, good. So this is going to cover the entire gamut. This is not going to be a tech talk. This is going to be an overview of what generative AI is. And by the way, almost every single image in this presentation was created by an AI called Midjourney, prompted by me. So you're going to see some generative AI in images throughout the presentation. My name is Vincent Serpico. I'm the owner of Founders Workshop and Metaverse Workshop. We're a 14-year-old dev shop in Phoenix, Arizona, that creates mobile apps, web apps, system workflows and integrations, metaverse worlds, and AR and VR. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. All right, everybody. So everyone knows the story of Michael Faraday and his famous demonstration of induction to a senior group of officials. And he demonstrated induction, and one of the officials said, "All right, Faraday, this is really interesting, but what use is it?" And reportedly, Faraday replied quite annoyed at the lack of vision of the senior official, "What use is a newborn baby?" Because we don't know what the use of it or the potential of it until it grows. And just like a newborn baby that has so much potential, it could grow up to be the next Gandhi or the next Einstein, or it could grow up to be the next Hitler or the next Khan. So, as I am writing this presentation, writing the outline for this presentation, I'm scribbling down ideas for outlines, throwing it away, whiteboarding ideas for outlines and throwing it away. When I said to myself, "Vincent, you lunatic, you're doing a presentation on generative AI. Why don't you just ask a generative AI for an outline for a 15-minute presentation about generative AI to a wide mixed audience?" And about 5 seconds later, it came out with something so much better than I ever could have thought of. Now, I didn't follow this exactly, but what it did was it gave me the basis to go ahead and create my presentation. It became a personal assistant to me to get me about 80% of the way there. So again, this happened in about 10 seconds, and I asked it for several other ideas, and it shot out a whole bunch of ideas. Let that sink in for a second because things are moving fast, very, very fast. I want you to take a look at this cartoon over here from 2015. The manager asked an AI assistant to go ahead and create a model to check whether or not a photo is of a national park. And she says, "Okay, great, I'll get it done in a couple of hours." And then he says, "Okay, also make sure that the photo can recognize a bird." And she says, "I'll need 5 years and a research team." And the joke behind it was impossible. You know, given all the time and all the money, it just couldn't be done in 2015. However, today, you can train a model to recognize a bird on an ordinary laptop in about 10 minutes, and any junior developer or tech-savvy person can do it. This is Sam Altman, the CEO of OpenAI, creators of ChatGPT, that is on everybody's lips right now. And he says that the magnitude of the socio-economical change that's going to happen is going to be faster than most people think. There's two important things in that statement you should take away from. The first one is that it's going to happen much faster than anyone in this room thinks, anybody. And the magnitude of the socio-economic change is going to be incredible, much more than any of us predict. Think of it like this. Let's do a thought experiment here that we can revisit during Q&A. What would happen if you took all the advancements from the beginning of the Renaissance up until 1990, and it happened all in 1 year? How would that affect society? You think that's crazy, and you think that's a wild thought experiment, but it's not so far off. Here are a couple of things that you can do with ChatGPT today. You can use ChatGPT to make a logo. You can use it to compose an entire song, a damn good one too, actually. You can use ChatGPT to write a book in one day. A really good book too, a 300 or 400 page book that would take an experienced author weeks or months. You can do, anyone in this room, in one day. You can create a 3D animation with ChatGPT. But wait, there's more. You can use it to write code, comment code, and debug code. I asked ChatGPT for an implementation for a Facebook login using C Sharp. It spat this out in about 10 seconds. I tried to stump it with a lot of other things, including write me a calculator in assembler. And it wrote a calculator in assembler in about 10 seconds. I then took uncommented code and I put it inside a ChatGPT and I asked it to comment it for me. And it created really, really good comment. So any of you who have developers working for you, there is now no excuse whatsoever for them to comment their code. It also debugs code. Take some code that is tricky to debug, put it into ChatGPT or put it into Copilot from GitHub, and it will completely debug your code. Here's some fun examples. Explain something like you're 5 years old. So explain to me quantum mechanics like I'm 5 years old, or explain the theory of black holes like I'm 5 years old, or explain something in a certain style, like explain emotional intelligence in the style of a 1940s wisecracking gangster or something like that. Ideas for art, decoration, party themes, lesson plans for educators, 10 ideas of what to do with your teenage kids that don't include social media. Find answers to homework assignments and questions, which those of you who are in college, I'm sure you've already done that. And we'll get to that in a little while. So there's a lot of entrepreneurs in this room. And you all have heard speed, quality, price, pick any two. Because we know that when you make things way better, way faster, or way cheaper, you become disruptive. Look at Amazon. Amazon is not really any better, and it's not really any cheaper, but it is way, way faster. So they make things way faster, and they completely disrupt the retail market. They put Sears out of business. Holiday shopping is all done on Amazon, and everyone in this room receives packages from Amazon weekly, if not daily. Now, what happens if you make things way faster and way cheaper and way better? You're not disruptive. Seismic paradigm shifts happen. That's what I'm trying to drive home, is that seismic paradigm shifts are going to happen. And Sam Altman goes on to say that it can be unbelievably good, but if it goes badly, it's lights out for all of us. Quote directly from the guy who created ChatGPT. And it's fun to have the conversation, and it's definitely worth having the conversation about where this is all going, what the dystopian future or utopian future would look like. But the bottom line is, you just got to put it out there. You just got to put it out there. You got to start using it. You got to see what value people are getting from it and how they're reacting to it. And AI being consumable by the general public is still very nascent, and already we're seeing crazy headlines. Google has called a code red meeting, bringing in the original founders, because ChatGPT is an existential threat to their entire business model. There's a lawsuit right now, a class action lawsuit against Stability AI, Midjourney, and DeviantArt. And there's really good arguments on both sides of the lawsuit, which we can talk about more during the Q&A. Colleges are in emergency mode right now. School boards have implemented a fraud detection system that they've been working on for 5 years that is now completely obsolete. Things are moving really fast. All right, here's some more fun examples of what you can do with ChatGPT. I'm a huge Star Trek fan, so I asked ChatGPT to create an adventure game based on Star Trek's Kobayashi Maru, which is a Starfleet training academy for training exercise for cadets. I asked it to describe each scene with three sentences, sci-fi heavy, and then give me three choices and play the game until the end. And we went through seven scenes and had a fun time. And you can do this right now. You can create your own adventure game. You can create an interview if you're going for an interview or going to give an interview. You can create a pitch if you're trying to pitch a VC or an angel. This is a quote from a friend of mine that owns a tech company from an email he sent to me, used with his permission. And one of the things he said in the email was, you know, by the way, my God, is this AI a game changer? We completely replaced our ad team and we're getting a lift of 20% greater than our ad team. So what does that say? They fired their entire, he fired their entire ad team. They're using ChatGPT and Midjourney, and the likes and shares are 20% greater than the humans did. Let that sink in. What else can you do with ChatGPT or any other generative AI? You can create an entire marketing campaign, the entire strategy for your marketing campaign. Describe your business, describe your competitors, describe your budget and your time frame. You can create the copy for a sales email or advertising copy for an SDR or LinkedIn or Facebook or whatever. You can create love letters. That's right. College kids are actually using ChatGPT to create love letters, emails, and things like that to their significant others. And you know, when I heard about this, I said to myself, if you get something from ChatGPT from someone else, do you take it, put it into ChatGPT, and then generate a response back? But it's not just images and text. It's images, it's text, it's video, it's code, it's speech synthesis, it's 3D. It's so much more. And there's tons of applications, marketing and advertising. If anyone in this room does marketing and advertising for a living and you're not using generative AI, you're at a huge competitive disadvantage because I guarantee you, your clients are. Personal assistants. Everyone in this room, everyone should be using generative AI as a personal assistant. If you need contents for a meeting or strategy for a meeting, let generative AI get you started. An email, a response, a strategy. Everyone in this room, if you're an artist, use Midjourney or Stable Diffusion to generate some ideas for you. Knowledge bases, video creation. Google and Facebook are both working on something. I checked out the videos. You enter a prompt and it'll create a 5 to 10 second video for you. Now, imagine what happens when it's a 10 second video, 30 seconds, a minute, 3 minutes, a 30 minute video. Can you imagine a time where you can type in a prompt or a paragraph and create an entire television series? It's not that far off, seriously. Code generation, debugging, and documentation is going to completely change the way we do coding. Speech synthesis. There's a product I believe Microsoft is working on right now where you enter 3 seconds of your own voice and it'll create a model for you for text to speech that sounds just like you. Again, the implications, right? Music creation, 3D assets. So creating 3D models is expensive and it's difficult and it's required for metaverse creation, for game creation, et cetera. But NVIDIA has something out right now where you can type in a prompt and it'll create the 3D asset for you. It goes a step further where you can type in a prompt and create an entire scene. Like for instance, I want a hospital scene from the 1920s, make it a little bit darker, add some more people to it. It gives you a great start. Imagine what that's gonna do to the creation of games and imagine what that's gonna do to the creation of metaverse worlds and the acceleration of the metaverse. AI characters you can have conversations with. In-world lets you go ahead and create these amazingly complex NPCs that you can have full-blown conversations with. Instead of scripting and dialoguing the characters in advance, in real time in the game, they'll respond and talk to you. You can try it out right now. Character AI has a whole bunch of characters you can have conversations with, real world as well as fictional characters, and they give really good responses. From Freud to Socrates to made-up anime characters. Of course, science, biology, chemistry, materials, design, robotics, exploration, we can go on and on. But let's talk about the AAA games because this is kind of interesting. It takes 3 to 5 years to create a AAA game. Budgets of 20 to 50 million, in some cases exceeding 100 million, and 50 to 200 team members, depending on the game itself across an entire gamut. I mean, look, it takes more to create a AAA game than it does to create an actual movie. Now, imagine a future not too far from now where a few ambitious kids inside their house are able to create a AAA game in about 3 months. All of these can be done right now on an alpha or MVP level with AI. You can create the strategy, the contents of the game using copy AI or ChatGPT. You can create the artwork and the 3D assets right now. The coding, we already talked about. The audio, the background music, the speech synthesis can be created with AI. QA with AI and an entire marketing campaign with AI. So you might think to yourself, that'll never happen, at least not anytime soon, because it does sound really, really fantastic. And you know, you might be right, but there's been other things that people thought were fantastic and couldn't happen and did wind up happening. Needless to say, VCs are pouring money on this like water on a fire. Here are some very recent headlines from some recent funding. Of course, the really big one is that Microsoft put $10 billion into OpenAI, the makers of ChatGPT. Yesterday, they released a new version of Teams that has a ton of AI incorporated into it. You almost cannot not get it. And Bing will have ChatGPT-4 inside of it, and they'll be monetizing ChatGPT also. Funny thing is, they announced this $10 billion investment around the same time they announced 10,000 people being laid off. AI is literally everywhere right now. These headlines are just from January, and these are all that I could fit. So it's a massive game changer, and I highly recommend you start learning about it now. So I'll be disseminating these slides. If you're a beginner, I recommend Midjourney or DALL-E, definitely ChatGPT. Here are a couple of links to go to that I'll get you started on how to do prompting. If you're mid-level, intermediate, I highly recommend going to GitHub and downloading Automatic 1111, where you don't need to be a programmer. It helps a little bit, but you don't have to be, where you can download the code for Stable Diffusion, and you can learn how to plug in various models for different effects you want in painting, out painting, as well as training your own models. And if you are tech savvy or a programmer, I highly recommend going to huggingface.co. It's a $60 million funded company that disseminates a ton of models. You can download models, you can train your own models and upload them. It's a really big crowd here tonight, and I know for sure that some of you are going to walk away and start training. And it's not infeasible to imagine that someone in this room will create the next $100 million AI company. The opportunity for trillion-dollar companies is exploding right now, and it doesn't require you to be a developer. It requires business acumen. It requires creativity. It requires everything that an entrepreneur is required, but doesn't require development. And just a quick plug, if you are one of those people, please reach out to Founders Workshop. Thank you. So this cartoon is from 1923, where the prediction was, in the year 2023, the idea dynamo will do all our work for us. Electricity will do all our work. It'll create the copy. It'll create the art. And the actual cartoonist and newspaper editor won't have to do anything. They were right. I mean, the old prediction of AI 5-10 years ago was that creative jobs will be the very last to be replaced by AI, if ever. And that the first jobs to be replaced will be the blue-collar jobs like mechanics and truck drivers. It seems just the opposite is happening. It seems that the creative jobs are the first that are going to be replaced, then the white-collar jobs like accountants, lawyers, et cetera. And then finally, mechanics and truck drivers, that's way off in the horizon. So the idea is that trying to predict what's going to happen with something this seismic is almost futile, but it's definitely, definitely worth the discussion. And what I want to do during the Q&A is make this definitely a Socratic Q&A, where please raise your hand for a question and then please raise your hand to answer the question. There's a lot of really, really smart people in this room, and let's make this a Socratic Q&A. Here's a few questions to get us started. Are we prepared as a society? What is the role of policymakers? And what jobs will be lost? What opportunities created? And I would love to hear what you have personally done or seen with generative AI. So,
really quick, Vincent Serpico, everybody.
Thanks.
All right, we're going to start in the back. You're going to make me work for it. That's cool. You have to say your name, and then you ask your question.
Hello, everyone. I'm Shep. I had a question about, like, how easy or difficult is it to, like, integrate this generative AI into, like, apps using, like, APIs or other things?
That's a really good question. So I'll start that answer, and then anyone else wants to answer, please do. So if you go to huggingface.co, what you're going to see are thousands of models. Those models can be downloaded and integrated in just about any application. And it's easier than ever to train your own model, train it on something very, very industry specific. Anybody else in here want to comment on that? Yeah, Kevin.
Hi, my name's Kevin. Just to answer that question, even if you're not tech savvy with the models and all that extra stuff, you could just use Zapier too, which allows you to connect all your tools together. And they have an OpenAI integration, which is really easy to use. Just to add quick stuff on that, you can create meeting notes really quickly inside of every meeting that gets recorded in Zoom. You can categorize all your data. There's a lot of good opportunities there with a tool like that too.
Great job, Vincent.
Thanks, Barbara.
I think this has been true in education for a long time, but I think this proves that it's true. It is no longer going to be about having the answers, but about asking the right questions. And so I think one of the big questions up here is, what is the role of education in this new space? And what's the role of educators?
That is a wonderful, wonderful question. I love how you phrase that the new paradigm is learning how to ask questions. Anyone in the education field, can you field that question, please?
Anybody in the education field? Yeah.
Sorry.
Make sure you say your name.
Hello, I'm Yanling Liao. I'm from Thunderbird. As I know, NYU already banned the open ChatGPT for thesis. And I don't know if ASU will ban later, but lots of universities will ban it because they stop the student's mind to think. You don't need to think. You just ask the answer. Then you don't have the learning process. You don't generate your own things or creativity. But on the other side, it's like a double sword because it will help the evolution to go through. So this is my understanding. Thank you.
Yeah, but banning it though, I mean, you can throw the shoes in the machine all you want, but technology is going to go ahead and advance. And just like Barbara said, it's time to rethink education now, not banning it.
I agree with what Vincent just said. So I teach at Grand Canyon University. My name is Tim Kelly. My thought is that the traditional sage on the stage model will die, that the traditional age brackets for credentialism will also be eliminated, and that we'll need to move to project-based problem solving from the earliest ages, perhaps as early as preschool. So who knows?
It's a good point, Tim. Thanks.
Hi, I'm Terrence. So I work at a company called Jasper, which is generative AI, and I teach people great how to use it every day. And one thing that I tell them is, it's like the calculator. When the calculator came out, no one knew what to do, and people evolved, and that's kind of our answer, my answer anyway.
Thank you.
So I just want to say that children are the ones who are going to learn and use it the way they want to use it, more so than us, because we all are used to a certain way of life, and they're not. And an example of this is that I think they're going to use this as a friend. So we're all requesting things, asking things, doing whatever. I tried it in a different way. I was trying to see if ChatGPT would actually ask me questions. So I started having a discussion with it, and I vented about emotional stuff just to see if it responds. And it started asking me questions. It started saying, oh, tell me more. Oh, this. Oh, what about this? Have you thought about this? It started literally being a therapist. And And a lot of troubled youth who have been in abusive situations, who don't have friends, who are alone, who are depressed, who are suicidal, who are whatever, might just use this and feel better and might even be directed to a therapist through this or be advised to do something like to avoid school shootings, for example, or other stuff like that.
Thanks, Mac.
Yeah, I'll take it. My name is Sasha. Hello, everyone. As a student, what I will say that schools need to shift more towards lighting that fire inside students, right? That passion, right? Because that's ultimately what's going to push through and have them persevere through the challenges, right? It's not going to be like, you know, I hate this concept of the weed out class. I think it's so stupid. Like, let's just like make kids hate our class, right? Or this subject. So I think the role of schools will it's putting pressure, like ChatGPT is really putting pressure on it, where okay, let's start making students actually passionate about, you know, what they're trying to do with their lives and actually build something.
Outstanding. Garrett had a question.
Eric Miller, one of our ambassadors. Thank you. Yes.
Okay, so and my understanding may be wrong, but my understanding of this generative is that it's going out and gathering existing information and summarizing and synthesizing and recombining it. What happens if we all start just doing it and no one's creating new content? Do we freeze human intellect in 2028?
That is an excellent, excellent question. I'm going to just slightly respond to that, but I'd love to hear what everyone else says. I think that human created art will wind up being more valuable in the future because we're all using generative art. So there'll be the notion of, oh, wow, a human actually wrote this poem or something like that. But by all means, you know, are we going to stagnate creativity?
Hi, everybody. I'm Gabriella Cojon. I teach at Glendale Community College. I teach entrepreneurship. To feed off that idea, what happens with critical thinking? If what we feed this tool is maybe not so great information or false, right? We get false results. So I feel the role of education will be in the end to have that critical thinking so you can spot issues and you can catch errors, right? That could lead to, well, no, bad things.
And just to kind of go on that subject as well, I think it's tough because what if it comes to subjects that are completely subjective, right? Like history, for example. One group of people might look at history in a completely different light than another group of people. And what is the AI prompted? What everything has bias, everyone has bias. People are building AI, people with biases are building AI. So therefore, I'm assuming AI will have bias as well. And how will that affect education and just the way people think and the way content is created?
That's a good point. So a question, my name is Chris. So when you did the Kobayashi test, and it's supposed to be a no-win scenario, if it told you how to win, which maybe it did, does that create a problem for us that we create a no-win scenario and AI can win?
So it actually did introduce a variable in the Kobayashi Maru that wasn't in the franchise that it allowed me to win at the end. And Mateo's point is really, really interesting about perspectives and biases. You know, in Vietnam, there is a museum for the American War, not the Vietnam War, right? And, you know, who's writing the AI and what perspective is it? And then what variables does that introduce into problem solving? So it's a really, really good point.
I'm always that guy, but we have to move on. Please give it up for Vincent Serpico, everybody.